I would say to any patient who is just diagnosed that I completely understand how overwhelming and fearful the term cancer is and all the connotations that it has for the future and prognosis. And, you know, certainly just about any patient, particularly patients who are in their 70s and 80s who hear the word cancer, it conjures to mind images of friends and family members from 30, 40 years ago having, you know, very old chemotherapy treatments and becoming horribly sick and usually not having the best outcome. And so it conjures to mind fear about the treatment, of course fear of death. And what I try to convey to patients immediately is that no matter where the journey goes, there is hope. There is hope. And I always try to be optimistic. I think even in situations where cancers have become quite advanced, if you are with a doctor who is appropriately aggressive and tailors a patient's treatment to their individual performance status and other health problems, that you can really come up with amazing results. You can beat statistics and improve survival and do all sorts of wonderful things, even when the books would tell you that you couldn't do that. Well, within the tool chest in oncology, there is still radiation, chemotherapy, and surgery, and you know all of them have their merits, and usually they have to work hand in hand to help cure a patient and get the best outcome. I think what's evolved over time is the techniques used. You know, there are new surgical techniques that minimize the amount of time a patient is in the operating room, minimize complications from surgery. For example, if patients had colon cancer in the past, they would have to have open operations and things could be more complicated. We can now do laparoscopic colon resections, things that are much faster, much cleaner, the complication rates are lower. You know, changes in technique with breast surgery. With radiation therapy, the advent of using what we call brachytherapy, or radiation that actually sits in a patient's body and then is removed after a short period of time. You know, this has revolutionized the way we treat certain lower-risk breast cancers after surgery is done. In addition, these sorts of strategies are used for prostate cancer, implantable radiation seeds, and so forth. So treatments with radiation, for example, these seeds, such that the day the seeds are implanted, within 24 to 36 hours, a patient can be back on the golf course or working. So the thrust has been to take the techniques we have and make them more tolerable, less complicated, but equally successful. And with chemotherapy, the same is true. Not only have we been able to design drugs that are better tolerated, but the medications that we use, for example, for nausea, have also evolved over time so that when patients come in and, you know, they tell you a story of their grandfather or grandmother receiving chemotherapy, you know, several pages have been turned in the medical handbook since then. And I spend a lot of time trying to debunk the idea that chemotherapy is intolerable. It is not intolerable. In fact, I tell patients that if you have a great deal of symptoms or problems after chemotherapy in this day and age, that's my fault, not the drug's fault. So I think that it's really just sort of an evolution of the drugs, the techniques, and again, making them more tolerable yet equally effective. I think also another exciting thing is radiation therapy in particular has really become an exciting field where in the past, radiation was more of a brute force thing where you just target a certain area and attack in a very wide treatment port. But now with the advent of things like rapid arc therapy and cyberknife radiotherapy, we're now targeting only the area where the tumor is and minimizing any exposure of the surrounding tissue to potentially damaging radiation. So again, an evolution in technique that's just amazing. And we have the capability to do all of those things at El Camino. Getting back to one other point on that is that chemotherapy is also sort of a brute force technique where you inject the chemicals into a person's body and hope that they affect the more rapidly growing cancer cells as opposed to the normal cells in the body. And they do. And the chemotherapy drugs work incredibly effectively for most cancers. But where we are headed with systemic treatment for medical oncologists is we are trying to target our therapy only to the cancer cells much more effectively. We do that using antibodies. We do that using new pills and medications that don't necessarily target just the growth rate of the cancer cells, but actually get into the machinery and the genetics of just the cancer cell to arrest their ability to grow and kill the cell while sparing all the normal cells any major side effects. So that's where treatment is headed. And again, I believe that we have access to all the things at El Camino that a place like Stanford and UCSF does in terms of conventional therapies, biotherapies, immunotherapy, all of these cutting-edge treatments. Well, I usually give several tips to the patients. First of all, I think that there are tons of ancillary services that can make treatment more tolerable. The first of which is, depending on a patient's personality, if they are incredibly afraid and fearful of what's to come next, I often will ask them to see a psychologist who specializes in the care of cancer patients. We use things such as antidepressants and anti-anxiety medications to make sure that, again, the mind, spirit, and body are all moving in the same direction, in a positive direction. And I think beyond that, techniques like acupuncture, guided imagery with music and art, behavioral modification, stress modification, all of these things are things that we have access to at the cancer center. Physical therapists who have specialized fields, another way to optimize your outcome with treatment. I think that I also tell treatments in terms of, I tell patients in terms of advocating for themselves that the most important thing to advocate for is to find a doctor whom you trust and who communicates with you in the way that you need to be communicated with. I think that in bigger centers, you often feel like a number when you receive your cancer treatment, and there's nothing more personal than cancer treatment. You have to feel like you're a person, and you have to feel, and what I strive to do is make sure that every patient I see feels like they are my only patient. And patients do feel that way here. When they see me, when they come in the front door, it's really a family. When they see the nurses, it's something where they receive the personal, tender, loving care, and you need to find a place like that. You have to find a place like that to have the best outcome.